Ian Rappaport, my compadre, at Rapsheet on Twitter, joining me here on The Rich Eisen Show. How are you, Ian?
What's happening, Rich?
Are you in mid-jog right now? Where are you?
Right now I'm in a wind golf driving range.
You are actually calling into this show and one of those rare moments where you can just tee it up? Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Bless you.
The 45 minutes where I hope nothing happens in the transaction world and I play golf badly and wonder why I play this game.
You commit like golf. I got it. All right. So
yes, exactly.
Before you go hit them straight, hopefully. I think the competition committee, to use the analogy, has shanked the shot here on the catch rule. Walk me through what has happened with the catch rule, if anything, Ian.
Unfortunately, nothing has really happened. I mean, the only thing that may change is really something that's been happening in the game in general, which is the reliance more on what was the actual call on the field. And it's not just catch. I mean, we've seen this over and over. Sort of a reliance more on there's not enough evidence to overturn, keeping the call, that the original call, and letting it all happen on the field. As far as the actual catch rule, you know, it's amazing. I mean, there's a lot of really smart people on the competition committee, GMs, coaches, referees. There's just not a better way. And so I think what they've decided to do is just hope that we, the public, media, announcers, do a better job explaining, like, what is a catch and do I know it when I see it? And so I think that's sort of the focus. I mean, everyone laughed when we said public education, but that's really it. It's just like when someone makes a play in a football field, do I understand what he actually did or did not do?
Yeah, but so why didn't they do anything then? When you say that there's no better way forward, was it a player safety issue that if they made any changes to the catch rule by making a catch more codified as two hands on the ball, 2 feet down on the ground, that it would open up defenseless receivers for more hits?
Yeah, that is part of it. It's, you know, if you go out of your way to absolutely make sure that you cradle it and, right, like you said, get two hands down, secure it, then does it limit your ability to look around and make sure that you don't get drilled by some safety?
Okay.
So that is part of it. It's amazing because they've tried so many different ways. You know, it used to be you have to make a football move. And then they took that out because that kind of didn't really help either. Now it's really just, do you complete the catch? Like, if you catch the ball, if you have 1 foot down, you know, if you catch the ball and you have 2 feet down, you've completed it.
Yes.
If you catch the ball and you have 1 foot down, you have to just finish off the catch when you hit the ground without letting the ball hit the ground. It should actually be fairly simple. And I say that, but also joining the millions who see something on the field and go, I don't know what the call is going to be here.
So I've got Ian Rappaport joining me here on the Rich Eisen Show. What about this rule that it seems like a red card, if you will, is coming to the NFL, that two personal foul penalties in the same game, unsportsmanlike conduct fouls, two of them and you're out. Do we know which fouls would be in the purview of two of these and you're gone, Ian?
Yeah, we do have an idea. I don't think it's going to be like two late hits and you're gone or two face mask penalties and you're gone. It's going to be like the stuff that should get you kicked out of the game, which is throwing a punch, which might get you kicked out just one foul. Mm-hmm. Taunting. If you taunt consecutively after plays two times, you know, that would probably get you kicked out. I mean, it's those sorts of things. Kicking, punching, taunting.
What about this, Ian, though? I mean, we saw Aqib Talib in the Super Bowl on the biggest stage possible, ripped down, I believe it was Jonathan Stewart, he ripped him down by the face mask because, as he said, he just knew the 15-yard penalty down at the 2-yard line. It's Philly Brown, pardon me, ripped him down at the 2-yard line. He knew all it would cost would just be 1 yard. Would something like that be considered a personal foul penalty that would count against you and then maybe an ejectionable offense if it's the second?
First of all, only someone who played for the Patriots would have that situational awareness of knowing, as you're committing a penalty, what the actual yardage would be based on.
So that was a Belichickian maneuver, even though he did it for Denver, is what you're saying?
Yes. Yeah. It's, you know, that's one of the things that they think about when you're down on the goal line. If you commit a penalty, it's 6 inches. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I don't believe Aqib Talib would have been tossed. I believe that a 15-yard face mask, unless unless it's ruled somehow more than just a simple 15-yard face mask, I don't. We'll have to check and see what they actually decide in Boca, because that really is one of the questions. But I don't believe Tlaib would have been tossed for his Super Bowl infraction.
Okay. Ian Rappaport joining me here on the Rich Eisen Show. Then they need to include stuff like that. If it's something that looks blatant, maybe they'll come up with something like a flagrant, something along those lines, like the NBA does. I know that would further confuse things. But if somebody does something that deliberate and dangerous, that should count for something like that. But that's just my two cents. What is going on with Kaepernick, as far as you could tell right now?
Seems like everyone's just chilling. There was, in a lot of these trades, everything gets emotional. It's just like negotiations. Everyone's juices were flowing that first day. Things were ramping up. Guys were throwing out draft picks here and there. And then once it didn't happen on that, I think it was a Friday, once that didn't happen, then it kind of just slowed, and everyone just took a step back, and it's like, hang on. What do I really want to give? Do I really want to pay $12 million for a quarterback I don't know who's going to be my starter? That's the situation in Cleveland, where they'd like to get him for like $7 million, which is fine, but then does Kaepernick take a pay cut to go to Cleveland? Right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Maybe he will to Denver with the possibility to earn it all back, but then does Denver want to give up its third round, does Denver want to give up its second round pick? Which is 63, I think, or something like that.
So is Fitzpatrick just sitting back and waiting for Kaepernick to move first, or what? Yeah, how do all these things work together?
Fitzpatrick is Brian Hoyer, who I'm sure will not be a member of the Texans next year.
Right.
He's kind of waiting.
RG3.
Everyone's waiting. RG3 is definitely waiting because, if the Broncos don't get Kaepernick, then RG3 is absolutely in play there. But I'm not sure any of this plays out before March. Is there a March 31st? There's not, right?
There's a March 30th. Okay. There's a March 31st, yes. And then there's an April 30th. So that was my question for you, is what's the date and deadline that spurs action for those who are listening and watching this show, the fans who could take something portable? What date do you look for?
April 1st is the date, because that is when his money becomes fully guaranteed, regardless of injury. Now, the other problem is he actually is injured. So you could make an argument that his money is guaranteed right now, because remember, he's getting over major shoulder surgery that he had. But April 1st is the day when his money becomes guaranteed, and that's the day where you'd say, all right, if the Broncos don't trade him by, or if the 49ers don't trade him by then, that's probably not going anywhere.
Okay, and then everyone else has to fall into place. What is the RG3 market, as far as you could tell right now, here on March 18th, Ian?
It seems like it's a very low to average backup market.
Huh.
And I don't exactly know what he's asking for, but, if there are coveted backups. There really are. Like, Chase Daniel was absolutely very coveted. He got a huge contract, crazy contract for a backup. RG3 is not going to get one of those. He's going to get like a, 2 year, $6 million or something like that, I would imagine.
Mm-hmm.
Come in, learn the game, and maybe you contribute, maybe you don't. Because the reality is, I'm not sure anyone actually knows what he is, even though he's been in the league for 4 years.
Ian Rappaport joining me here. A couple more before, again, you go back off to the golf course. Jared Goff's pro day is today. Hugh Jackson reportedly is there. It's in the backyard, obviously, of the San Francisco 49ers, figuratively, if you consider Berkeley a backyard of Santa Clara. But that said, what are you hearing about the Wentz-Goff race as we are entering the final month of evaluation here?
Yeah, also worth noting that Mike Silver, I know this may surprise you, is also in the house for CalPro.
They actually credentialed him? They actually got a credential?
I'm pretty sure he's going to be working out, running the 40, and throwing.
Why wouldn't he do that? Why wouldn't he do that? He's that nutty.
Yeah. I have not heard right now that Cleveland has a winner. But my sense is that it ends up being Jared Goff. Just reading the tea leaves and knowing what I know, and seems like he may be a little bit quicker, whereas Carson Wentz obviously played at a much different level of college competition. I mean, Joe Flacco didn't start right off the bat. That's the Carson Wentz sort of comparison. So I think the Browns would like someone to come in and play right away. So maybe Goff comes in and plays a little bit sooner.
Wow.
But this this is going to be a weird quarterback year. I mean, the comparison I always make is, and I don't mean this negatively, although it probably sounds like that, is that it's going to be like the Gabbert, Locker, Ponder year.
Right.
Because it's just, they're all kind of similar-ish. It's just what flavor you like.
Okay, so last one, yes or no, Mark Sanchez is the opening night starter as a banner goes up in Denver, Colorado. What do you got for me?
I say no, but it's not – that should be crazy. We should all be making fun of you, but that is actually not crazy.
Don't make fun. I mean, that's serious. I'm serious.
Happen. And I'll just tell you, there are some Broncos people right now who are thinking, and this is supposed to be a yes, no answer, I know, but there are some Broncos people thinking right now, you know what? If Sanchez played average, he's probably better than the quarterbacking we got in the
Super Bowl. Now, that said, look, I know that everyone's mentioning Peyton Manning, 17 interceptions, and Sanchez in his years with the Jets and Eagles, as we all know, was prone to turn it over sometimes. But Manning didn't turn it over a single time when he got back in there, not once. Not a one single pick from week 17 all the way to the winner's podium where he's talking about Bud Lights. Not one of them. So,
and Papa John's.
Yeah, he did. Well, I think he hugged Papa John. But I think you know what I'm saying. So yeah.
No, you're absolutely right. Absolutely right. But you know, like, it's funny, we all talk about like which big name quarterback they're gonna get, and
yeah.
The Osweiler thing was a huge deal. You know, Brian Hoyer had a very similar passer rating to Brock Osweiler. Sanchez could probably do the same thing. This is a defensive team who's gonna run the ball.
All right, it sounds like you're gonna be teeing off into the wind, Ian. Is that an accurate?
Yeah, it's actually side wind, so it's honestly gonna be a disaster.
Is this a Lynx course situation, Ian? Are we linking today?
It is not. It just feels like it. It's, and just to make me even happier, there's a lot of very small green, so it's just going to be a disaster.
Postage stamps, that's what they're called, Ian. Thanks for joining. I appreciate it. Good luck to you, sir.
Thanks.
Good luck to you. That's Ian Rappaport, NFL Media Group, right here on The Rich Eisen Show.
The Rich Eisen Show, weekdays at noon Eastern. On Audience.